Hi, I'm Michelle Nunn, President and CEO of the international humanitarian organization CARE. Our team works in 100 countries, and so we are experiencing the spread of COVID-19 around the world in a profound and a powerful way. In many parts of the world, diseases as deadly as COVID-19 have struck before. For 75 years, we at CARE have helped in the hotspots, working where famine, conflict, and disaster strike to bring life-saving aid and to help communities build back stronger and more resilient. We were on the front lines for the Ebola crisis in West Africa and have fought outbreaks of cholera and Zika in some of the world's most vulnerable and hard-to-reach communities. We've learned lessons we can apply together to keep a COVID-19 tidal wave from killing millions of people in the global south, but we must act now. Places like India and Nigeria, where the virus is now spreading, are densely populated and have millions of people living in tight quarters in slums without access to running water, reliable electricity, or sanitation. Imagine if every time you wanted to wash your hands, you had to walk 2 miles to access clean water. In Syria and other places with millions of displaced refugees, conditions are even worse. In the Cox's Bazar refugee camp in Bangladesh, home to 885,000 displaced people, there is only one testing facility in the whole country, and it's 10 hours away. So how do we slow the disease's spread in these parts of the world? It's harder, but it is possible. Here are 5 things we can do. First, bring on the basics. Soap, potable water, and other household products for personal hygiene. While many of us are washing our hands 10 or more times a day to help prevent contracting and spreading the virus, many families we work with are unable to give their children a bath and clean water even once a week. CARE and other relief organizations are rising to the challenges in places like Mozambique and Bangladesh and Somalia. We're providing soap, installing hand washing stations, and building water storage tanks. Second, strengthen basic health infrastructure. If the onset and rapid spread of the virus is overwhelming healthcare facilities here in the U.S., imagine what it will do in places with just as many people, but less than 1/100th the number of doctors and nurses, and fewer and poorer healthcare facilities. It's daunting. Still, there are ways to help make the healthcare clinics and hospitals that do exist serve patients as effectively as possible by pre-positioning supplies and reinforcing sanitation to minimize infection, which CARE and others are doing in places like South Sudan and Ethiopia. We learned from the Ebola outbreak in West Africa how heavy a toll a pandemic can take on the healthcare workforce when providers don't have adequate protective gear or aren't trained on protective protocols. 1 out of 10 providers treating Ebola died from the disease. Protecting our frontline staff is of paramount importance. We're organizing capacity building sessions for medical team members in Corona preparedness, prevention, and response in the West Bank and Gaza, including physicians, nurses, and community health workers, as well as custodians on general hygiene measures. Third, empower local women leaders. Women are the vanguard of community resilience and will be the linchpin in this fight. Why? Because in communities around the world, women are the glue. They care for their children and often their aging relatives, manage the household, support each other, and their farming or shopkeeping carries the daily income that translates to the nightly meal. CARE has learned to put women at the center as drivers of change, and it's imperative that we act on that as we take on this challenge. In Sri Lanka, for example, women business owners are coming together to devote their time and resources to prevent the spread of the coronavirus. An owner of a baby's clothing store there coordinated an effort with other women entrepreneurs to produce 1,800 reusable face masks for the government and delivered those sewn masks free of charge to people in remote areas. These women were able to not only help combat the virus, but to keep their staffs, many of them who were women-headed households, working. Fourth, combat the infodemic of misinformation. The Ebola and Zika battles taught us that community trust made the difference between life and death. Trust of information and acceptance of those offering guidance is paramount. Social media can be an important route to information and how-to videos. It can also be a source of misinformation and dangerous theories. We're mobilizing community volunteers in places like Nigeria, Haiti, and Nepal to go door to door with important facts and guidance to help prevent, respond to, and mitigate outbreaks. We're also translating World Health Organization guidance into local languages and supplementing written materials with radio and social media posts. And finally, lend a hand and raise your voice. Preventing the impending tidal wave of COVID-19 will take all of us. It will take everyone following guidelines for their own health and safety to stop the spread. It will take our collective advocacy, including encouraging U.S. and European government response to include additional funding for prevention and response in development and humanitarian settings. And it will take financial support from individuals, foundations, and corporations, many of whom are already answering the call. We and others are working with trusted partners on the ground to assess what's needed at the country and community level and tailoring programs to that need. We won't succeed without them, and we won't succeed without you. So let me say again, when it comes to a highly contagious virus, no community is safe until every community is safe. If we act now, and if we act together, we save lives, and in so doing, we protect all of us. Thank you.